My name is Adam Q. I'm a Duke graduate of 2013, so relatively recently. While I was at Duke, I helped launch a couple companies I'm going to be talking about today. But more importantly, I'm going to be talking about how Duke has become the ideal incubator for new and innovative ideas and for the people that are moving those ideas forward. For those of you involved in tech and those of you involved in finance in the crowd, you might be familiar with some of what I'm talking about, but I'm going to go into a couple tech investment truisms and how Duke actually proves these things very true and how Duke is making those things true today. The first one I want to talk about is this idea, and it sounds simple, but it's actually really hard to do, is if you're investing in an idea or investing in a product that solves a real problem. So it sounds simple, but let me take you through an example of how this happens in the real world and why that's actually a big issue and an issue that Duke's gotten correct. So say I'm a young college graduate like myself. I'm out walking my dog in the middle of the night, and I'm trying to think of this new, whatever new startup idea is going to make me rich beyond my wildest dream. I'm trying to think about what's that next thing that no one's thought of yet. I look down, and I have this aha moment. The light bulb goes off. I see this dog that I spend hundreds of bucks every week on its food and its shelter, and people love their pets. People buy clothes for their pets. People do anything for their pets. I mean, there's a ton of money here. I'm going to make a social network for pets. It's going to be awesome. It's going to be Facebook for pets. I'll sign up. I'll get to meet other people with pets. We'll get to share our love of pets and whatever it is that I would do. I haven't thought that far ahead. So I go to a local Silicon Valley investor VC firm on Sand Hill Road, and I say, hey, look, there's $61 billion in the last year spent on pets alone in the United States. That's huge. In my first year, I'm just going to get a little bit. I'm going to get 1% of that. That's $610 million in 1 year. This is going to be incredible. You guys are crazy for not investing in me. They give me all the money in the world. I go get a team of smart software engineers and marketers from Duke. I build an office in Silicon Valley. I go around the world talking about this idea. And a few years later, it turns out that everything I built didn't matter because no one actually wants a Facebook for pets. It's not something that people want. This happens all the time, and I guarantee you every single investment firm in this area has done this, maybe not this quite as bad of an example, but has done this before. Let me give you an example of how Duke solves this. So when I was a sophomore at Duke, I got connected with a professor in the environmental school who had a problem. He was teaching a few classes, and for each class, there was not a perfect textbook for each of his classes. So he needed his students, really he wanted them to buy like 3 to 4 textbooks, and they would use a little bit of each of them, and buying one textbook is already shitty enough for students, so buying 4 is just out of the question. And so we're thinking, there's got to be something better that we could do. And so we had a few meetings, and we really collided on the fact that there are these new tools that he could get his class to use that would actually help solve this problem. And so we decided, hey, let's go build a textbook of ourselves. Let's make it digital so you can change whatever you want to change about it. You can bring in outside sources. You can make your own material and see if people like using that. And so, summer session after my sophomore year, we launched a textbook to one of his classes just to see how they used it, see how they liked having all their homework readings, how they liked having all of their lesson plans all in one place. They could take it on the go, they could use it on the plane, they could use it during class. It was one thing everywhere for them. The professor could go and make his own idealized lessons plan, so this didn't exist anywhere else. He made it easy for the class to combine this with outside research and academic papers. Students, while they were using the app, could highlight different sections and take notes on sections and talk with the class in real time about what they thought about different parts of the lecture or different parts of the reading. The professor could chime in at any point and they could answer questions that way. And we found it to be pretty successful. So we used it for that summer. Students really enjoyed it. The professor loved it. It was a much better experience for him. They got through a lot more material than they would have otherwise. Instead of in the fall, we're like, okay, we'll make this bigger. We'll use this in a few of his different classes at Duke, and we'll put it on the App Store and see what people do. And we couldn't even have imagined what really happened next, right? So we put it on the App Store. Classes, colleges, high schools, individuals all over the country started following along with the class. Teachers started using the app to teach their own classes because it ended up being a better textbook for other people as well. People even took the framework that we built and started using it for physics classes and math classes and things that weren't even related to marine megafauna, which is what this class was about. And it was really, really astounding for us. The important part to mention about this class also is that I was initially connected with Professor Johnston through a Duke computer science class. We had met through this class. He knew he had a problem that he needed someone to be able to solve, and we synced up through that class and then ended up having this happen, which is a pattern that happens consistently at Duke in classes, in entrepreneurship groups, of Duke using Duke students to solve Duke problems. It's a really powerful thing because, like I said before, A, you're guaranteed that it's a real problem. It's not pet space. But the second thing, the second example I wanted to poke at was that last part, that Duke problems piece. Because it turns out that Duke problems are pretty rarely only confined to Duke. There's actually a lot of places around the world where if you were to solve a Duke problem, you're solving a problem there as well. The example that I would use there in the real world, in the investing world, is Facebook, right? So Facebook launched at Harvard and existed in Harvard for a good period of time until it became the skeleton of what we know as Facebook today. And during that time, they were able to change things. They were able to get feedback based because they had 1,000 users instead of 1 billion users. After they had a model that worked at Harvard, it turns out students at Duke also wanted to talk to their friends in the same way that students at Harvard did. Their parents wanted to, and it turns out everyone in the world actually wants to communicate that way. This textbook example was actually a pretty good example of Duke doing that same thing. We didn't know we were doing that at the time. But when we started, we only made it for one summer session, one class at one school. We solved the problems for that particular class and school. So, for example, when we launched, we didn't realize that people would actually want to use the app when they weren't connected to the internet. So students would go on a plane and then all their readings were gone. And so then we knew we had to fix that. It was better fixing that for 30 people than for 30,000 people. Once we had solved this problem for this one class, we would say, okay, we solved it, maybe solve it for a few other classes. And it turned out we solved it for educators all around the world. It's an example of the power of this phrase, of Duke students solving Duke problems. And Duke really understands the power of this phrase, which is why they've invested so much in Duke Forward, which is why they've invested so much in entrepreneurship groups. And that's really what I want you guys to take away from today, is that this happening and these examples of innovation happening at Duke that you're hearing today are not just happening. They are very actively happening by contributions from Duke. Duke is very aware of the opportunity and the ability that it has to change what secondary education means in the 21st century. And so they're actively doing it. Like I said, that's why we're all here today. That's why this event exists, is because Duke very much understands that this is something it can play an active role in. In a world where I can take a math curriculum online on YouTube for free, what is the value of secondary education? Duke gets that one of the ways that that happens is that you're going to meet with world-class faculty like you've seen today. You're going to meet with intelligent students. Duke is going to be the place where the next big ideas are coming from. Duke is going to be the place where the people that are creating the next big companies or changing the current great companies from within, if Duke's the place where those people are coming from, that's why you go to school in the 21st century. That's why you go to Duke even when you can take a Duke class online. And that's just something that we learn with the digital textbook, but it's something that Duke has espoused and Duke has made sure, like I said, that's why we're all here. The reason I believe in this so fully also is because I lived out that experience at Duke. I lived that experience of what the ideal 21st century education system is going to mean for higher education. And so my sophomore year, when I was working on that textbook, I had also moved out here to Palo Alto for the summer. And I was working at a startup called Mailbox, which we eventually launched an app my senior year of college. It was an email application. And then we got acquired by Dropbox, who's out here also. And so we made that email app for a couple reasons. One was we made it because we knew it solved a real problem. Everyone in this room uses email. There was no guarantee, like if we made something of value, it was actually going to be of value. We had a small group of people from our previous product that we could test with. If you notice, those are two things that I learned directly from working on Cachalot, working on that digital textbook at Duke. My experience at Duke would have been totally different without this. My postgraduate career wouldn't have been possible without these Duke experiences that Duke Forward has helped fund and you guys have all helped funded. So I personally want to thank you all for being here and for supporting Duke and supporting Duke Forward and continuing to do so in the future, because these are the type of things that have exponential effects as they go on. So thank you guys again for coming out, and I'll be in the back by the food and the bar if you have any questions at the end.